Today I fucked up by unknowingly hosting a fruit fly breeding hub in my closet for 6 months of my life. TW, eating disorder. Insects, probably don't read if you also have OCD. This is an incredibly convoluted story and, honestly, really fucked up. I never thought anyone outside of the people I'm living with would know about it. However, I've recently been browsing this subreddit. After reading about a guy fucking a maggot-infested coconut, feel like I, subjectively, did not fuck up as much as that. Although this might be equally disgusting. This event happened exactly a year ago now, and while it was genuinely one of the most traumatic periods of my life, I can laugh about it now as it's honestly funny how my mind became my biggest enemy. In February of 2019, I stumbled into a large sum of money and decided that I would take my grandma on vacation. She has been my sole provider throughout my life and works tirelessly, so I took her to Tennessee and we created memories I'll never forget. A very integral part of this tale is that I have OCD. One of my biggest triggers is insects. So when I returned home from my trip and sat down at my PC to play some games, it did not take me long to notice these tiny little brown gnats flying past my peripheral. I panicked. I realized that I had accidentally left out half of a lemon in my room before I went on my trip. I immediately suit up, decked out in 3 pairs of gloves and clothes that I later threw away, and I disposed of the lemon. Problem solved, right? Upon the removal of this lemon, it seemed to me that the fruit flies dissipated after a few days. Everything was fine, until they came back. I could not, for the life of me, figure out where the fuck they were coming from. The lemon was gone. Once I eliminated the source, it seemed to me that based on thousands of compulsive internet searches and hours spent reading, that the fruit flies would go away. I took every piece of furniture out of my room, vacuumed for hours, scrubbed every possible surface, disinfected every nook and cranny, just to appease the thoughts in my head that perhaps they had laid eggs somewhere that I could not visibly see. I made sure not to bring any source of liquid or food into my room. Nothing helped. The fuckers were multiplying at rapid speed. I deep cleaned my kitchen, scrubbed every vegetable and fruit we owned, made sure the trash was taken outside multiple times per day, even though it seemed that they only existed in my room. But there was nothing in there. The straw that broke the camel's back was when I was laying down in my bed and one landed upon my arm. Absolutely not. I began to hyperventilate. I jumped out of bed, turned on my lights, and realized that they were everywhere. It felt like my world was crumbling around me. I felt trapped. The idea that they were flying around me and I could not possibly kill every single one, I could not know where they were at every moment, the idea that they were crawling on me and oh god, the bacteria. A complete and utter loss of control. I deemed then that my room was uninhabitable. I could not go in there. I set up maybe 10 vinegar/soap traps within my room. Placed paper on top of every vent and taped it shut. I shoved a towel under my door. I vowed then that absolutely under no circumstances would I open the door, and nobody else could so much as even touch the doorknob. I had to get out, and they could not come with me. Over the next few weeks, my room was in lockdown. I slept in the spare bedroom, although I did not get much sleep. I lived in constant fear that a fruit fly would escape from my room and taunt me again. I stayed vigilant, always watching. I couldn't focus on anything because my brain told me I must stay alert. I eventually set up vinegar traps throughout my entire home just for some slight peace of mind. As time proceeded, I realized that somehow, despite having no real exit or entrance, the fruit flies escaped my room. I broke down. Felt like I had nowhere to go in my own home. Nowhere felt safe to me. I was constantly reminded that I was not the one in control. It didn't matter where I was in the house, I would see a fruit fly, and it would send me into an unrelenting panic attack. My family eventually got fed up with me refusing even to enter that side of the house. They decided that since I would not, they would go inside and inspect. For some reason, it never occurred to me to look in my closet. What could possibly be in the closet? All I had in there were clothes I didn't wear. I didn't use my closet because I kept all of my clothes in the spare bedroom. However, This oversight was my biggest mistake. My grandmother found the source of my turmoil. The past 6 months of my life were spent living in constant fear and confusion. I'd racked my brain for every possible answer, cleaned everything and anything, and could not, for the life of me, figure out the source. There were thousands of fruit flies caught in my traps, and yet they seemingly never ended. My closet was a bag. It was decaying and rotten. It was absolutely disgusting. It was covered in fruit fly maggots, tons of adult fruit flies feasting upon the contents of this bag, and it struck me that this entire ordeal was entirely my fault. I have been bulimic since I was 14 years old. Most of the time, I would simply purge my meal into the toilet and go on with my day. However, at some point that I can't remember, I'd needed to purge and had company over, so I vomited into a plastic bag and hid it in my closet. That point, I had never faced any real, in my face consequences from my eating disorder. My teeth have been fine. Sure, I got nauseous when I ate, but, to me, that only made it easier to do what I do. This was my wake-up call. This was my slap in the face, the final realization that I truly had a problem. The last 6 years that I spent face down in the toilet with two fingers down my throat, it all came to bite me in the ass in a way I never could have precedented. I spent 6 months of my life genuinely believing that I was going crazy. Lost absorbent amounts of sleep, endured multiple panic attacks daily, and it all came down to my toxic relationship with food. I hope anyone who has made it this far can understand the overwhelming guilt and shame I felt when I found out that this disgusting vomit bag, the product of my eating disorder, was also the catalyst for 6 months of my insanity. I hope this goes to show the evil and relentless grip that our own psyche can have upon us when we are sick. Something as small as fruit flies probably does not mean much to the average person, but I still am sent into panic if I see a flying insect. It seems so silly to have trauma associated with such a thing, but I will never forget the sense of doom I felt standing in a swarm of insects. Anywho, that's my story of how I unknowingly sponsored the most notorious fruit fly orgy, in my closet. Too long didn't read, today I fucked up by unknowingly breeding thousands of fruit flies in my closet by forgetting that I'd left a bag of my own vomit in there as a result of my eating disorder. It, quite frankly, I didn't expect anyone to read this because it's a literal novel. Thank you for all the awards and gold. I am glad that some people can get some kind of entertainment from this. It's kind of funny to me now too. I did leave a few things out because I'd already written so much, but I keep seeing similar comments, so I'll just put it here. 1. The vomit was not in clear sight. It was tucked away back in the back, underneath a lot of things. It's not like no one else never looked in the closet, it just wasn't until someone searched deeply that they found it. The bag was under comforters and other shit. The closet was just a major oversight. Looking back in retrospect, I want to beat the shit out of myself for not looking earlier, but I obviously can't take any of that back now. The closet is so ignored that I really just forget it exists, and in my panic state, all logic and reason kind of goes out the window. 2. No, the smell of vomit did not penetrate into my room. By the time the vomit actually smelled, it only smelled right around the bag and a little bit in the closet. I moved out of the room very early into this story, and by then, my room smelled of vinegar, disinfectants, and bug spray. Cause there were so many traps, the predominant smell was vinegar, so I suppose that is why none of us ever smelled the vomit. 3. Most people with OCD know that there are multiple ways that OCD can manifest. It is not always the over-organization, arranging, and cleaning that is represented in media. I'd never had any issues with insects in my home. My room was not unkempt besides this bag. I have completely different and unrelated compulsions and obsessions. Some people question how I can have OCD if I forgot a bag of vomit in my closet. I've personally never read that criterion in the DSM or heard from my psychiatrist, but I will be sure to ask her next time. 4. Thank you to everyone being kind about this experience and my eating disorder, even though this story is gross as hell and really embarrassing. I have been in recovery for several months now and am happy to say I haven't purged in months, so I definitely don't have to worry about this occurring again. Thank you all, stay safe and take care. Oh, and don't leave vomit bags in your closet. That's one hell of a wake-up call, Op. I'm really happy you're in a better place in your life, and I sincerely wish you the best. Also, I can totally relate to the torment caused by flies, fruit or otherwise, and I hope those dirty bastards rot in hell. D. My brother did this same thing with an old lunchbox in my closet. School ended and he left an apple and some snacks in there, then chucked it into my closet. Our house filled up with flies. One day I go to check lunchbox. Flies, worms, and the spawn of Satan greeted me with zeal. It took us weeks to fully eradicate their presence. And now their remnants haunt my scarred home. I literally knew exactly what this was as soon as I saw the eating disorder trigger warning. Just know that you are not alone in this experience and try not to be too disturbed by it. It's over now and the flies will go away. I hope that you're able to get some help. Oh my god, I hope you're doing better now. But this is also kind of hilarious. It reminds me of the one time I hid a half-eaten Adam's apple, usually an apple on a stick covered in sugar, under my bed because of my binge eating habits and I was too embarrassed to admit to my mom my intention of eating this whole thing. Well, some days and hundreds of fruit flies later she found the apple, which only made it way more embarrassing than anticipated. I'm glad you can share this story with us, because I'm still too embarrassed to even talk to my mom about it. I forgot about a bag of potatoes once in a cupboard. Similar story, although less intense and shorter duration, but still retaining some of the mystery. Despite not having any sort of OCD or insect phobia, it was still really awful. And it was not so personal as to happen to my bedroom. I can't even wrap my head around the torment I must have gone through. Today I fucked up by dreaming that I was in a game of tennis. This happened yesterday. I was sleeping and had a dream about tennis. I was in a match and it was going really well, hitting winners and smashes. Then I realized that my dream felt pretty real and I could feel myself hitting the ball and I could feel my hands gripping around the racket. Suddenly my dream shifted and I was standing in my own room, next to my bed. I realized, while dreaming, that I was still holding the tennis racket in my hand and that my room was not the right place to tennis, with my PC and monitor on my desk and the limited space available for a swing. So I put the racket away and went back to sleep. And I really woke up the next morning and felt confused, because at that time I did not know if the second part of the dream really happened or that it was just a dream. I then looked into my room and saw that I had TIFU. While dreaming I had picked up my tennis racket earlier and swung with it. I accidentally had hit my monitor and it had fallen off the desk onto the ground. I now have to buy a new monitor. TL Doctor, while dreaming about tennis I hit my monitor off the desk curl. Can you send a pic of the shattered monitor? My boyfriend also has dreams like that. About a week ago he literally woke me up and was all panicked that we have a huge venomous spider in the bed. He was looking for it and beating around his pillow. It happens to him at least once a month, and I totally got used to it. But at first I was so confused, lol. Also sometimes he just wakes me up to talk. Weird lad. That's awesome and glad to know that I am not the only one who does this. My wife has told me that I have sang to her, tried to save her from massive spider, and I also tried to tell some kinda dad joke and would wake myself up laughing lmao. When I was in school we had been playing volleyball in PE the day before, and I was half asleep in bed the next morning. You know when dreaming you're sitting on a fence or something and you jolt yourself awake when you start to fall off? It was like that. But I was dreaming I was playing volleyball and the ball was coming straight at me, so I put my hands together and went to hit the ball, but in reality I smashed both my hands into my bedside table and chipped my wrist. 4 or 5 years ago I had a dream that I was fighting someone. We ended up wrestling on the ground and he was in a position where he could bite my inner thigh. In the dream I threw my leg back forcefully to avoid the bite. Unfortunately, I also threw my leg back IRL, and threw myself right out of bed. I woke up about halfway to the floor, just in time to thud flat on my back. It jolted me enough that I just laid there for a few minutes, doing a slow check to make sure everything was okay. Reminds me of the time my dad dreamed he was playing soccer, despite having never played in his life. He went to kick the ball in the dream and kicked himself out of his bed IRL. Broke a knuckle in his hand falling on the floor, I forget which hand, I wanna say left, and I don't think he'd ever fully recovered. This is exactly why you don't do drugs, kids. Other, don't play tennis. Dangerous game. First that dude hits the tennis boy in the face. And now Op is destroying his PC. Today I fucked up by thinking the cute girl at the mall was into me. Too long didn't read. Cute girl working at store was doing her job and got me to buy a lot of stuff. A couple weeks ago, I was at the mall, and went to the fashion store named Buckle. It's totally my style and I love everything about the place. Well, this cute girl came to help me out, but she went above and beyond by asking my name unsolicited, handing me a few more articles to try on with what I had, etc. When I was checking out, she asked for my phone number for the thing, and I told her. I almost tacked on, "And you can put that in your phone too," but I didn't, lol. Left the store with $200 less in my bank account, but some pretty rad clothes. But $200. I would not have spent that if she hadn't sold me on it. Well, today I went back because I needed a pair of khakis for my job. I go in, and another lady does the same things, asks my name, super friendly, handed me stuff to try on with the khakis. I even overheard the same thing going on with another customer, which cemented that the first girl was definitely not into me, just a great saleswoman. If someone is at their job, and being very nice to you, always assume they're just being positive for the sake of their job, not flirting with you. That's literally what I'm doing for the rest of my life. I'm just always gonna assume everyone doesn't like me unless they say otherwise. I think I accidentally gave you a award. Oops. Oh ha 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 ha. I once tipped a server at Buffalo Wild Wings $20 on an $18 dab. She sat down at our booth and talked to my friend and I and was super friendly. Yeah, I know what she was doing, but fuck it. I once went with a friend to a strip club, kinda early, so we were there before any of the girls. First time for both of us, so we're super awkward and put of place. Well, we were probably some of the only patrons there at the time, so when one of the girls arrived, well, she saw us and probably thought she should go ahead and get an early start. We ended up chatting for a good bit, 20 to 30 minutes, I'm sure, about her typical small talk to hook people and me asking what it was like. Definitely a stiff atmosphere. I'm not sure if it'll make sense, but we went ahead and left. But on the way out, we handed her about the cost of a dance, just what we had in our pockets at that moment, and I thanked her for her time and insight. It was a nice little conversation, and really, that was probably not the easiest money she made, but it was probably one of the strangest. You can't just not tip well when someone goes above and beyond. Life pro tip: if you see a girl working in a store and you think she's into you, she's not. She's doing her job. Sad but true. I'm a bartender and occasionally a guy will ask for my hash or something and it's mad creepy to me. Don't get me wrong, it's flattering and tells me I must be doing a good job of being friendly, but puts me in a terribly uncomfortable position turning them down. If you think someone on the clock likes you, let them make the move. I had the same experience at Buckle at the Mall of America, and it worked. The dude was insanely friendly and complimenting, kept getting me outfits and was like my mother, telling me if it worked or not. Also ending up spending a couple hundred. I didn't really mind though, as I did like the clothing they picked. Yes, I loved the clothes she got me too. Just shaky on the $200 is all.